Mirror in the Hall. As soon as I was born, the haze-like reddish darkness faded, and my eyes opened into a void where no light entered. I could only feel an emptiness encircling and sheathing me. I went on peering into the void until blank sight was replaced by an unknown sensation. I felt someone thumping my back. Suddenly, all sorts of strange noises, feeble as well as loud, attacked my consciousness. As shadows began swirling around me and unknown odors assaulted my senses, the warm and much familiar smell receded and retreated into the recent yet familiar past. I saw her. She was in all white, but the jet black eyes made a contrast. The startling whiteness was unsettling and frightened me, but the dark eyes held me in a spell. Their whirlpool depths bewitched and transfixed me into submission. I could feel her, but she seemed unaware of my fresh consciousness. She went on patting my back, thumping me, swaying me back and forth, and looking at me with great concern. The darkness of her eyes was filled with worry. "Sister, somebody beloved." She hurriedly opened her purse and her slender fingers moved about so quickly and delicately that I was mesmerized. She slipped out a small mirror from her purse as if easing a baby from recalcitrant womb. She wanted me to look at myself before I looked out at the unknown world. But before she could place the mirror before my face, I had already discovered myself. Her jet black eyes were so clear and reflective that I had seen myself as well as my identification badge. Unaware of my discovery, she went on polishing the mirror, and soon after the mirror was clear enough, she held it in front of me. I was still captivated by the darkness of her eyes and realizing that I was not looking at the mirror, she whispered, "Look, have a look before you see anything else." I could barely understand her. What I saw was the image of a premature infant about a minute old with embryonic liquid still clinging onto a pink feather soft piece. This image looked down possessively at me from the mirror. Satisfied, she slowly put me down. My eyes clung to her as she rummaged through her purse again, fished out a thick pencil, held the mirror in front of her face, and applied the pencil onto her rather conspicuous lips. The lips started glowing red. Quickly, she lowered her face. Now, her lips were more prominent than her eyes, and she planted a hurried kiss on my cheek. I started crying for the first time, I think. My crying was terrifying even to myself. It was completely different from the noises that I had been accustomed to. A reassuring pat fell on my back. It was my mother trying to calm me, but I went on bawling because I wanted to listen to this new exciting sound. This went on till some new presence came up to me. I was startled by whiteness, though of a different kind. Mother said he was my father. Daddy had a strong, broad face with a bluish tinge in his eyes. Bushy eyebrows gave him a fearsome look. He wore a white dhoti, white full-sleeved shirt, and white cap, representative of the nation's freedom struggle. The cap, I was to learn later, also ensured a quick ascent on the power ladder after independence. His obsession with white was all pervasive. Except for his eyes and dark bushy eyebrows, he was a white man. His stern look stopped my hauling. He winked and smiled a typical half smile, which failed to arouse any confidence in me, and I continued sobbing. A black crow settled on the branch of a peepal tree was visible from where I was lying. It suddenly opened its long beak and crowed loudly. I started howling again. My father dashed to the window and closed it with a bang. My mother tried to calm me down and ask my father to open the window. He refused to do so. How could he allow his son to look at a black crow, the bearer of bad tidings? Moreover, it was totally black, opposed to his sense of pristine whiteness. It was a huge mansion with many rooms and a spacious hall. My father, a busy and influential man, would often meet visitors at the entrance. He would allow visitors to enter the hall only after they had washed their hands and feet at the entrance. All this trouble, I was told, was for the sake of a large mirror, a family heirloom which had been handed down for at least 4 generations, and father wanted to keep it absolutely clean and pure. Often he would peep inside while discussing serious matters with visitors just to find out what I was up to. He would repeatedly say, "Go and wash your hands, they are dirty. Look at your feet, go wash them first." These instructions would be repeated like a litany every day. "Let me see your hands, wash them first. Let me see your hands well. Let me see your feet, wash them first. Let me see your feet, good. Wash your hands, wash your feet. Wash your face, good." My mother's task was to keep a strict watch on me. I should not play with urchins, I should not play with clay, or I would become dirty. I used to wonder how he kept himself so clean despite meeting so many dirty fellows every day in the hall. I could not understand why I was not allowed to play. What if my hands and feet got dirty? I could always wash them before I entered the hall so that the family mirror remained uncontaminated. How could I not touch and play with Mother Earth? I desperately wanted to mold clay into beautiful images and idols, but I dared not. Not with my father anxiously hovering about in the background. The commandments of "Thou shalt not" become too much to bear. One day I simply went out, used the water meant for washing one's hands and feet for softening clay, and clumsily began making various idols. When I returned home, my mother was sitting in a corner. her forehead clean as a slate. She did not say a word about my dirty hands and feet. I did not notice that there was no kumkum on her forehead. I looked at the mirror in the hall. It was cracked, as if somebody had thrown a stone at it. My face was also divided along the lines of the splintered glass surface. Suddenly, I realized why the mirror had cracked. I had been telling him not to try and enter the mirror. How could one wash images? In the far corner of the mirror, I could see bits and pieces of forms I had created from mud.